My name is Malik Galani. I'm the executive director at Silk Road Rising, and I'd like to welcome you to our panel tonight entitled Building a Theater of Inclusion, Perspectives on Asian American Casting and Producing. The panel is sponsored by the League of Chicago Theaters, Silk Road Rising, and Lifeline Theater. The panel came together through conversations with our steering committee members, and they are Deb Clapp and Ben Thiem of the League of Chicago Theaters, Dorothy Milne and Ellison Kane of Lifeline Theater, Chay Yew, Jeffrey Scott, and Tim Spiker at Victory Gardens Theater, Adam Belcour at the Goodman Theater, Danny Bernardo of Bailiwick Theater, and Jamil Khoury at Silk Road Rising. I'd like to also thank the Chicago Temple, the First United Methodist Church, and Phil Blackwell, who's the senior pastor, who's here with us tonight. They are the hosting institution for Silk Road Rising, and they allow us to do the work that we're doing here. So with no further ado, I'd like to introduce Danny Bernardo, our moderator. Please give him a warm welcome.
Yeah, so first off, thank you for coming out on a drizzly night, and I'm just amazed at how diverse this audience is. It's oddly inspiring, and it's great. Malik said, this panel and this conversation came together after a series of conversations pertaining to some casting controversies as of last year, specifically to the Asian American experience. The Asian American Performer Action Coalition did a study, and it turns out on the Broadway stage last season, only 3% of the casts were represented by Asian Pacific Americans. And this past year's study that just came out a few days ago, that's 3% also for not-for-profit theaters, which is amazing because on the Broadway commercial stage, they'd always been lagging slightly behind, but for the not-for-profits, in the last two seasons, they have started to dwarf. They've been dwarfed by the Broadway stage, and we only have 3% representation. So it's really exciting to be a part of this conversation now, when it's so important to a lot of us, and for some of us who've been part of this conversation for like many, many years. A couple of housekeeping things. Usually at this point of any performance or anything that you'd be at a theater, they'd ask you to turn off your cell phones. I actually am asking you to keep your cell phones on, but turn the ringer off, you know, so it's not to bother anyone. We are unfortunately not able to live stream, but we are running a Twitter feed. So if you do tweet, whether it's a question that you want to address in the panel later, even though we will have a Q&A, a proper Q&A, or if there are any inspirational thoughts or any like sound bites that any one of my amazing panelists bring up, please use hashtag API Chicago, and that way it'll get out to the whole Twitterverse. We've got people on all coasts following this hashtag. So, and unfortunately they can't be with us, at least through live stream, so it'd be great for them to be able to follow us on Twitter. So I talked about some controversies, and the three that stick out in my mind, four, of the past year. The Nightingale at La Jolla Playhouse, a workshop that happened summer of 2012, was brought to the world by the team that did Spring Awakening. And it was based on a Hans Christian Andersen story set in China, but the team set it in mythic China, which then, because it's such a mythical land, and the majority of the cast was non-Asian, and that caused quite a controversy, obviously, especially because the previous workshop was all Asian. So they had a forum discussion, a town hall discussion at the La Jolla Playhouse. Orphan of Zhao opened in the fall at the Royal Shakespeare Company, and it's famously known as the Chinese Hamlet. There were only three East Asian actors in the production, two of which played puppet dogs, and one played a servant. Locally, we had, this one's gonna be a little tough, we had Pippin, a Bollywood spectacular at Circle Theater. Two of the biggest issues with Pippin, a Bollywood spectacular at Circle Theater were, one was that there was no Asian or South Asian representation on the stage, but most importantly, there was no South Asian dramaturgy involved in it. There were no South Asians in the conversation, so many in the community felt that it was exoticizing a culture. And a show at Lifeline Theater, one of our sponsoring theaters, Bridge of Birds, was a story that is set in and around China with the conceit that it would be a storytelling piece told by a multicultural cast. And that caused some upset in the community as well. So we're going to discuss all of these things at length over the course of our time together. But I'm going to ask my panelists, who I'm about to intro. Well, actually, let me intro my panelists now. So sorry, I'm just so excited to be having this conversation. We've been in talks about this since October, so it's crazy that it's happening. To my right is Chay Yew, the artistic director of Victory Gardens, playwright director. So give Chay a warm round of applause. David Henry Hwang, acclaimed playwright who flew in from New York this morning to be with us today, needs no more introduction than that. So thank you, David, for joining us. Jamil Khoury, artistic director of Silk Road Rising and a good friend of mine, amazing artist. So thank you, Jamil, for hosting us. And another dear friend of mine, wonderful actress, beautiful soprano, Eliza Shin. Good to have you. So I'm going to ask my panelists just as a warm-up question. And I know we're all artists, so it's really hard to be able to do this. I'm going to ask for a one-word response. It's really hard. It just, for those of us who've had therapy, think of it as your therapist saying word association. So we're going to go through... I'm just going to say the name of the controversy. We're going to start with Chay, and we're going to popcorn down this way. One word response. Nightingale.
One word?
Yes, one word.
I can't think of one word.
Okay, we'll start with Eliza.
Yeah, sorry.
Oh, no, it's fine.
Catalytic.
Catalytic.
Clueless.
Clueless.
Lazy.
Lazy.
Couple of words. Wrong.
Wrong. Why wrong, Jay?
Well, I think if it's set in a country, a specific country, one would hope that the people that are represented would actually be on the same stage. For example, you wouldn't do a white version of Raisin in the Sun. So why would you do basically a multicultural version of a certain story? And the question is whether the story has been told before too or mm-hmm. not.
Yeah.
I think it's complicated in that way, and I don't know what the circumstances really are. I just find that if you're telling a story about a certain place, you would hope that that country is being represented by the people that belong to the cast.
Cool. Yeah. Orphan of Zao.
Oh, me first, Dan?
Yeah, we'll go with you first.
Oh, that one? Heartbreaking.
Maddening.
Maddening.
Arrogant.
Yes.
Wrong.
So I'm gonna ask David and Eliza to elaborate. So David, why arrogant?
That's such a strong word. I just thought the reaction of the RSC to the Zhao controversy, sure. They were sort of like the poster children for how not to respond to one of these controversies. This idea that initially they were going, well, we were casting a number of productions. This was an ensemble thing. And we were also doing a Brecht play and somebody else. So, we couldn't cast that many Asians. That's like literally defining how the playing field is unequal. That it's okay for Caucasians to play Asians, but it's not okay for Asians to play anything but Asians.
Right.
It's sort of what's mine is mine, and what's yours is mine also.
You got it too.
Eliza, heartbreaking.
I lived in Switzerland for a year after college, and the amount of racism I encountered on the street by that time I'm a grown adult, was mind-boggling, because it's a different continent, and things are different there, and I taught at an American boarding school, but I had Japanese students, Spanish students from wherever. And I asked my Japanese students, you know, because one day it happened to me, I said, how often does it happen to you that you go down into town and you hear something or people do stuff? And they're like, oh, Miss Shin, every day, all the time. Whenever they went down into this nice, picturesque Swiss village, they would always get some sort of racist comment. And by seeing this come out, I was like, and listening, reading what the British East Asians were trying to say, I was like, oh my God, that was me in this country 10, 15 years ago, having to assert my ability to speak this language without an accent. And that for me was just, it was heartbreaking.
Yeah. What was heartbreaking to me too about Orphan of Jail was that, that the reviews that came out were like, well, there's one, I think it's a Guardian, don't quote me, and if I'm wrong, I'll tweet it out. Like, just kidding, it was this source and I'll link it. But it said, you know, it didn't matter. It didn't detract from the story that, like, it wasn't told with Asians. And that, to me, was heartbreaking. All right, so the last one we're going to do for this little warm-up. Pippin, a Bollywood spectacular.
Ugh.
Does that come to work?
Yeah, it's got to.
Can I say two words?
Two words.
Irresponsible and insensitive.
Responsible.
I have to say ignorant because I'm a little ignorant of that situation.
And since they were expressing something, I'll just say diligence. I just wish there was more diligence.
Yeah. Do you want to elaborate?
Yeah,
on
sure.
Yours?
You know, I mean, it was a case of such. I did not see the show, so full disclosure, and you know, we were never approached about. But there was such a clear-cut case of a cultural appropriation taking place. From everything I've heard, and the fact that there was no engagement with South Asian community, and there was no attempt at what we would consider responsible dramaturgy around the show, I'm looking at Kamal Hansu, you know, is so reckless in light of everything we as a community ought to know by this time.
Mm-hmm.
And referring to Bollywood as kind of an aesthetic style as opposed to having an actual grounding in the cultural production of a nation and a people, I think also really diminishes the, you know, South Asian artistic production and expression. So I know that they came back and said there was no ill intent and so forth, and it's just kind of a once again, an aesthetic choice, but I don't know that those are choices that we can make in a vacuum any longer.
Absolutely.
And that is what I believe occurred.
And that's what today is about, which is
yes.
So exciting. So I with Pippin and Bollywood Spectacular specifically, there was, when the production photos got released, there was such an outcry from the South Asian community because it, in ways, it felt like Yellowface. A lot of people, or brown face, you know, were telling me there were turbans and thick eyeliner and bindis and ill-fitting colors for a widow. You know, it's these things that if in the conversation, if a South Asian was in the conversation, that wouldn't have happened. And it just reminded me of being a kid and watching Breakfast at Tiffany's for the first time and seeing Mickey Rooney. And, you know, not thinking anything of it, but then you're like, wait, that's what you think of me. Funny story, I didn't know I was Asian until I was 10, and my agent told me, well, you didn't get this part because you don't look like the mom. And it just never occurred to me that I was different. And then I went back and watched Breakfast at Tiffany's, and my mind was blown. I mean, that's what I saw reflected back at me. And so it's really great to have these conversations now, but it's been going on for so long. David and Chay, you guys have been pretty much the first voices for the Asian American community in the theater. I'm going to ask you guys just to talk about, you know, from a historical perspective, what breaking into the industry was like for you. I have a couple follow-up questions after that.
As someone who's here to represent so long ago. I'm just long ago. I mean, actually, the question of how I broke into the field is it's incredibly relevant to the conversation we're having today, because I was 23 when Joe Papp produced my first play, FOB, at the Public Theater in New York City. But how did that happen? How does a play go from a dormitory to opening at the Public Theater 14 months later? And it was because around the time that I was doing this play in my dorm, the Public Theater produced a play called New Jerusalem by Len Jenkin, in which a Caucasian actor was cast in an Asian role. And this led to protests by Asian actors of that day, which predated Miss Saigon by 10 years, and of course our controversies by considerably more than that. And so, you know, Joe Papp being sort of having the values that he had, the Asian actors of that day protested it in front of the Public Theater. Joe kind of invited them in and ended up hiring one of them onto his staff, a guy named David Oyama, who is now a reporter for Wall Street Journal, to write to find plays for Asian actors. And it was just about that time that my play came across his desk. So I always consider myself a beneficiary of affirmative action, because there was an opportunity that was created. I was the person who was fortunate enough to walk through that door, and so I've, you know, always felt like I have a certain responsibility to that too. But I was given this opportunity because there was community pressure, because of a political act that was in response to a piece of yellow-faced casting. And so it's how I got my start is incredibly related to the conversation we're having right now.
Well, I don't have too much to say except that as a beneficiary of what David had gone through, I was actually in Boston and I was working in TV and film and was writing stuff. And one of the things that I had to do was to do a thesis script. And I set mine basically in Boston. And all the characters were just basically Caucasian. And the touring production of M. Butterfly came to Boston. And David was giving a speech at Brandeis. You probably don't remember. Yeah, like that lonely person in the corner saying hello to you. But he said a few words. Okay. But seeing the play and actually having David speak really at on the panel that he was talking about M. Butterfly's process, like you, I didn't realize that there was this notion of what being Asian American was. I saw myself as basically everyone else. Mm. And there was this history that I was given or I was part of that I didn't realize. And I think as a result of that, what happened was I began to figure out what it really means to be Asian American. So when I went back to that thesis play, I just decided to make one character, the lead, Asian. And it came out into a place where everyone's first play was, who are you, what are you, the identity play. And the play was actually Porcelain Went to the Royal Court. But that play basically came out because
Wow.
Did I tell you?
Wow, you
don't tell me. So what is cool is that, you know, things happen, it's a domino effect, generation to generation, person to person. This is a lineage, and I'm sure from where we had left off, there are other people too that follows that, Asian and non-Asian, about your stories being told the way it needs to be told, because the collective history is American history. American history is not one color, but a rainbow of diverse, beautiful colors. The white story is the Latino story. The Latino story is the Jewish story. The Jewish story is the black story. The question is, how do we tell that correctly so that we own them? Because this is our, these are our stories.
See, and I just keep going back to, that makes so much sense. If you guys haven't read Porcelain, it's beautiful, but the protagonist is a character named John Lee, and we find out later that his Chinese name is Lone Lee, and it's just this beautiful moment when you see his journey. It's like, wow. Tears. David, you touched a little bit on the Miss Saigon protests. Can you elaborate just a little bit?
So, in 1991, the West End musical Miss Saigon was set to transfer to Broadway. And I had friends, some of you have seen Yellow Face, I wrote a little bit about this in that. But some of our friends had seen it in London on the West End, and they were like, oh, there's this Jonathan Pryce, you know, guy who's playing a Eurasian or Asian or something, pimpy, has his eyes all taped up. And we were, and I remember thinking, oh, well, that could never happen here. And so then when Miss Saigon was announced to come to New York, they announced that Jonathan Pryce would be reprising his role. And this led to a big culture wars incident of the early 90s. It really only lasted about a week, but it was kind of an intense week. And those of us who kind of condemned this as yellow face casting, there were a lot of things, a lot of complicated forces that came into play. There was sort of the whole weight of the commercial theater that was looking to this as being a big, big money-making hit. And so we were sort of standing in the way of that. And I actually think the issue of casting is quite a complicated one and a nuanced one. And there's a lot of interesting ways to talk about, well, what does it mean to play a role? What does it mean to play a race in life? What does it mean to play it on stage? And what does it mean, can you be a member of a race and be playing your own race? I think there's all sorts of interesting questions. But in that context, it got reduced to kind of a media smackdown very quickly, just like who was going to win and who was going to lose. And you felt people kind of run to their natural positions and just kind of put up barricades. And there was no real opportunity for an intelligent or nuanced discussion about it. And it was a little scary, honestly, for me. And I felt like, wow, everybody's so angry. The minorities were going, we're angry because we've been denied these opportunities for so long. And, white people are angry because they're like, well, why do we have to give up our artistic freedom for this? And I think that I got kind of freaked out by the whole thing for about 15 years. I think I wrote a play, Face Value, to try to process it, and that was a huge flop. And then eventually, I wrote Yellowface and was able to kind of get my arms around what happened. But I think it kind of blocked me as a writer, just doing original plays for about 15 years. And so what's interesting about it is I always felt that we lost that battle, but we won the war, in the sense that Jonathan Pryce did end up doing the role on Broadway. At the same time, Cameron McIntosh, the producer, said that any future engineer would be cast with an Asian, and he was true to his word. I mean, Miss Saigon ran for the next 10 years, and all the engineers were Asian. And then I thought, well, at least people now know, a producer knows that if you cast a white person as an Asian, they're at least going to have to put up with a lot of crap. And then they can decide whether they want to do that. But of course, it's been kind of surprising to me that all these other issues, that all these other examples have been raised in the last year or so. There's been this sort of resurgence of yellow face casting. And the last thing I want to say about Miss Saigon is that, there's this whole, when the controversy broke, the producers used the "we're really casting the best person for the job" argument. So there is this whole thing about, we did a worldwide casting search, we couldn't find anyone qualified to play the engineer. So I was in a car with Nick Heitner about 3 years later, and we were going to the airport or something. And Nick directed Miss Saigon. He's now the artistic director of the National Theatre in London. And we were just talking about what had happened back then. And he was feeling bad about it, and he said, he was a young director at that point. Anyway, and he said that he was so embarrassed by the Cameron McIntosh sort of saying that we'd done this worldwide talent search, and his words to me were, we'd always intended to bring Jonathan. He was our friend, which I thought was so honest and true. That's how it happens, right? We're all, those of us in theater, that's, you did it with your buddy, you're coming to Broadway, you bring your buddy. I feel like whenever a theater or a producer says, oh, we looked, but we couldn't find anyone, I think the burden of the proof is on the theater, because lots of times they're just lying.
Wow. I want to elaborate on something. A big struggle about protesting against this was the potential of putting all of these actors out of work, that could be getting it. What were some of the discussions had around that? Because I know there were, especially what you wrote in Yellowface, there were so many people that were militant and trying to get your support. Was there any fear of that backlash?
Well, you know, okay, so when the Yellowface controversy erupted, then Cameron McIntosh sort of said he was going to take his toys and go home, that he was going to cancel the production of Miss Saigon. And then the argument became, oh, look, you know, you've sort of lost all these jobs. I mean, for my money, the idea that Miss Saigon was going to be canceled was always sort of a feint. It was a really good feint, you know, it sort of scared the New York theater community. But I don't think there was ever, I don't think that in and of itself really deterred the Asian American protesters of that day, because I think there was the sense that, I mean, he's not going to cancel it. And B, it was sort of a more important issue. It was more important to get the issue out there even than these sort of jobs that really nobody had been cast in anyway at that point. You know, I had this crazy idea at one point, which nobody liked, which was, okay, what we need to, this is a musical that's based on, like, sexy exoticizing of Asian women. So all we have to do is get no Asian women to audition, and then you've totally screwed the show. Nobody liked that idea.
Well, it wasn't one of the concessions was that he wouldn't appear in Yellowface.
Yeah, I mean, Jonathan Pike didn't end up, you know, taping his eyes and everything when he was in New York, and that was, I guess, better.
Something. But then you're just like, why is this white guy like singing about the American Dream? It's like, God.
So that goes to me. That goes into choosing a season and choosing stories that can be told accurately. Like an argument against, for example, Pippin, A Bollywood Spectacular was, do the research. If you can cast it or accurately or have these have South Asians in the conversation, that's when you should tell it. I know on a personal anecdote, when Portsmouth Music Theater did Pacific Overtures in 2009, they scouted for the whole year before they announced it to make sure they had enough Asian American actors to be able to fill the cast, which I think, well, I mean, selfishly, being part of that cast was awesome, but it was very responsible. So, what are some of your challenges, Chay, like having Victory Gardens, being the artistic director of choosing your season and challenges as a director when it comes to casting and selection?
Well, first and foremostly, I mean, I'm not basically invented the wheel. I mean,
yeah.
Victory Gardens has been here for the last 38 odd years, and Dennis Zajac and Marcy, who is here, they were the ones that basically championed the notion of what new plays are, and Dennis had a very strong social political agenda, which is basically to reflect the plurality of what Chicago really was. So what is happening is I'm basically doing the version 2.0 of that, which is basically now what is Chicago's face in 2012. And again, also not reinventing the wheel, David and I also came from one person who basically championed this kind of theater, Joe Pat, and in my time, is George C. Wolfe.
Mm.
George Wolfe always told me when we first met and finally he produced my work, he said that he believes that an American theater should only be called an American theater if Americans are represented, and the Americans I see across the street, in the alleyways, everywhere has to be represented. It was something that I held on, and also with my relationship with Gordon Davidson, who really believed that, you know, there is such thing as this thing for social dialogue. So saying all these things, this is what I'm basically carrying to Victory Gardens. I do have an agenda, and my agenda is I would really love to see the population of Chicago reflected in my theater. It's a golden gleaming dream, but that's what I wake up to, that's what I think about. I wake up to also knowing that this city is segregated, and it's our job as theater artists to figure out how to open these invisible borders to create bridges. I'm not alone. There are wonderful people here who have their own theaters and who are artists who are doing the same thing, small scale and large scale. So the question becomes, how do we start doing that? I think the only two things I'm doing is trying to figure out how I can reach out to communities which reflect Chicago. What are the plays that we need to be doing? Secondly, if there's some plays which have a second or third production, I've asked the playwrights whether they are interested in seeing a non-traditional version of it. And we did two versions, two different productions this year. One's a world premiere play, which is non-traditional, set in Chicago in 1920. Philip Dawkins' Failure, a love story. And the second play was actually Equivocation by Bill Kane. And I said, why don't we see a non-traditional cast do, you know, Elizabethan England? He agreed. So that is a wonderful way that we can start creating conversations and dialogue. Again, I think we're doing one bit, and I just hope not to be the only person in the classroom doing this. And I encourage, I think, all my fellow Chicago Theater Arts and administrators and leaders to think about that as well.
Absolutely. So this is a part of a bigger conversation, obviously, in the theaters, in the global and national theater scope, but I mean specifically to Chicago. You spoke about how segregated the city is, which as Chicagoans we all know and feel. What are some of the differences you notice working in Chicago theater versus any other city you've worked in?
I think Chicago traditionally and historically has been tribal. I mean, that's the way the city has been built, which is kind of interesting, fascinating. And I think that's wonderful things that happen too, because in each theater company, and let's talk about theaters too, is that each theater has its own DNA, which is so special and unique. But I think the big challenge for us is how do we start mixing the DNA? So, which is a wonderful, exciting thing too, because one theater company's members could go to another one to work. I think two theater companies can benefit from this. And the notion of that dialogue and building bridges is actually very exciting. I think insularity, at some point, I would only think that you start repeating yourself. Mm-hmm. And you know what happens when people start inbreeding. Which is a good thing. This is a world and a country where you can get online and speak and chat with someone in China and in Pakistan. So if the fact that these borders are so radical, our city needs to basically take up the challenge and figure out how do we can find different ways of colliding. I think collision is a wonderful thing. Mm-hmm. I'm seeing it in every theater company. The good one does it. You know, Charlie's Theater is doing it. The thing is, I encourage even the smaller theater companies to think about what does it mean to live in a plural, inclusive America. Remember, just November, America had a wake-up call. They finally saw the true face of what this country is. And those who didn't believe it lost the election.
Yeah, I want to piggyback on what you're saying about the smaller theater companies picking up the torch. I was talking with Behzad Dabu and Manita Gandhi yesterday from Disconnect at Victory Gardens, and we had a great chat about just multiculturalism and some of the discussions happening after the show. And Behzad brought up a really great point brought up by a friend of ours who is an African-American actress, that the big theaters, for the most part, are doing it right in terms of casting multiculturally, of doing the outreach. And it's the smaller theaters that I'm finding that, or you know, that we're finding that are having a little trouble with it or not necessarily doing it as much. And you know, the question that I'd like to bring up later is, you know, is it a matter of resources? Is it a matter of just, you know, we're all college buddies and we want to bring our friends in. But so using that as a segue to the other side of the table, what's great is that so many of the faces I see in the audience are people I'll run into at O'Connor or TPR or, you know, their Asian call went out and here we are, you know, sitting together. So, Eliza, as an Asian American actress, what are some of the challenges you are facing?
I knew you were going to ask this question. I feel like I have to go backwards a little bit.
Please.
Just to, I'm going to try to keep this short, but I think these are really important points. I am the child of immigrants, and immigrants with faces like my parents were not really allowed into this country in big numbers until the Immigration and Nationality Act of 1965. My parents are now naturalized U.S. citizens, and from 1790 to 1952, the only immigrants who could naturalize were, correct me if I'm wrong, they were whites of, I think it was like, whites of good moral morally upstanding whites is how it was phrased. So it's not until 1965 that we start seeing really big numbers of native-born, native-speaking, non-white U.S. citizens. And I bring that up because I think at least for those of us born between, you know, here from 1965 up to about 1980, I think I'm kind of typical of this group. Not everybody, and forgive me if I don't include you, but I am not a trained actor. I have a bachelor's in chemistry. I think most of us, you know, my fire-breathing aerialist, beautiful friend Amy Chen in New York City has a law degree. You know, the lovely Christine Lin from Chinglish is an engineer. I mean, we come from this type of beginning. So the challenges I've faced are accepting for myself that it's a viable option and convincing other people that it is an acceptable, viable option for me to do something like this.
Well, because most artists, when they go to their parents and say, I want to be an actor, you know, most artists' parents are, whoa, you know, the opportunities for you as a Caucasian or, you know, anything else is slimmer, but for us...
At the same time, the thing is, I mean, I'll be honest, though, like, theatrically, I'm, like, when it comes to theatrical versus commercial, theatrically, for me, I'm, like, super way behind, partially because it's not as easy for me to get on stage. Mm-hmm. On the other side of that fence, on camera, I've been the benefactor of race on the on-camera side. Mm-hmm. There's no question about it. When it comes to industrials and, you know, commercial, I mean, U.S. Bank, all this stuff, Walmart, I mean, there, I cannot say that my color hasn't helped me, because that'd be a complete lie.
Mm-hmm.
So it does cut both ways. It helps that on-camera is a faster-moving target than theater.
Yeah.
So that's part of it.
Cool. And I, just knowing you as a person, you're very passionate, which I love, and you're so well thought in. So, and I preface this by saying, one of the catalysts for this conversation was, like I mentioned, Bridge of Birds at Lifeline. You had a hand in that conversation, and again, we have people from Lifeline here to respond as well if we want to keep the dialogue, as we keep the dialogue two-way. So do you want to respond to that a little bit?
So this, what happened, I'm glad you said that Saigon was scary, because this was kind of scary. I got wind that Bridge of Birds was going to be done by Lifeline, and if you don't know Lifeline, it's wonderful theater, and they adapt literary pieces, and I don't know how I found out it was about China, but in my mind I'm like, oh, slam dunk, I am in that, and I read the wonderful book, and then, and also another thing that was part of it is that I had worked with Allison, I don't know where you are in here, Allison and I worked already together as colleagues in a stage reading, so this wasn't Allison, managing director of Lifeline Theater, the largest non-equity theater in Chicago. This was somebody I knew. And I think that's something to always remember. We are just all people, despite all these labels or titles. And Allison told me it was going to be multi-culti, and I'm like, sure! I'm Asian, my stuff gets done multi-culti all the time. I've gotten so used to it. I've been in those productions until we were doing something at Silk Road, and I was talking about this with another Asian American actor, and I was like, yeah, they're going to do it multi-culti. And this person, because I talked to them, I'm not allowed to use their name, because I'm kind of paraphrasing. They looked at me and they're like, I hate it when they do that. We've got the talent in this town. And for about 6 weeks, I still defended my position in Lifeline's position. Lifeline was full of people that I knew and respected. Scott Barsotti's working. Like, I was like, are you kidding? We don't have nearly enough talent. People can't do a production of 300 pages of tracing through China, not making multi-culti. And then the adaptation comes out, it needs 6 people. And then I was like, oh, I'm kind of... And then it made me realize, too, I have no right. I have no right not supporting my kind. I was like, what am I doing?
So it was Eliza introduced me to the conversation, and I reached out to Allison and Dorothy. And so this is, I mean, I just want to applaud you for your bravery, because I know it was really scary. It's tough when we spend so much of our time just being thankful to have work. You know, we're just thankful to have work. And that has come up in so many of our conversations as a steering committee. And I feel like in our many conversations, that our community has been seen as so submissive just by, you know, so being able to stand up is hard because we're just thankful for it. And to their credit, I
yes.
Rob Kozlerik, who's the casting director for Lifeline, approached me and I was booked, and it's that difficult thing of everyone was pretty much booked at that time, and so I gave him everyone I knew that at that time. So it's they did the outreach.
I do want to point out, though, around the same time, because I auditioned twice, and every time I auditioned, I was the only Caucasian in the room. But at the same time, I was also auditioning for Pretty Wendy. I mean, Finn's right here in the front row, and it wanted ninjas versus pirates, Romeo and Juliet, and I show up to this call, and I'm like, holy mackerel, there are all these Asian American Juliets. Like, you know,
yeah.
There was no slam dunk anywhere based on race. It was such a wonderful experience to be like, and that was really the thing that I'm like, I have no right to not say we don't have enough people in town. Because you were paying us with beer, I think. And this was gonna cost all of us. You did the right thing. And everybody showed up, and I'm like, they're coming every summer. They're coming every semester. They're coming all the time.
Awesome. Yeah, no, I want to just segue really quick because I want to be mindful of time, and I know we have a lot of actors in the room as well that when we open it up, we can definitely keep the dialogue going. I just, again, want to applaud you for your bravery, for speaking up, and start essentially initializing this conversation, which is great and why we're here now. And like, it's moments like that, it's moments like that, and it's the big joke, not joke, but the funny story of how Danny Bernardo came into Bailiwick, Chicago was, they were, which is related to that, the company before I joined it was doing Bloody Bloody Andrew Jackson, which is one of my favorite rock musicals. It's just fun. And they put out the call, they had cast out of the ensemble that was already there, and they put out two male calls, one that could play guitar, that could lead the band, and Andrew Jackson. I don't know how to play guitar. So I was like, you know what? F it, I'm gonna submit. And I wrote in the notes, like, dude, is there anything else about you you'd like to say? I was like, yeah, I'd F the role, I'd rock the F out of this role. And they called me in, and then from that conversation, they're like, who are you? This is awesome. And that's how my partnership started. So it sometimes it just takes that initial, you know, oomph to get change happening. I want to segue to my dear friend, but Jamil, sorry. Like any couple friends. Yeah. So Jamil and Malik started Silk Road in response to September 11th, which was a really brave thing when America wasn't ready to see South Asian, Middle Eastern faces, let alone stories. But you guys have thrived, and you guys are so successful. You guys do such great work, and I've been blessed to work with you guys often. So in terms of choosing, I mean, you know, I asked Shay about choosing stories and choosing plays. By your mission statement, you do Middle Eastern, Asian, South Asian work. What are some of the challenges in just doing it and being in it?
Can I go back to Pippin for
yes.
a second?
Absolutely. Yes.
I'm segueing it too.
Yes.
Because there was something, you know, once again, not having seen it, but you know, read about and all the responses. There is a very rich and complicated relationship in South Asia between Islam and Hinduism, and it's not to be taken lightly. Mm-hmm. And to mix sacred images and sacred metaphors in a very sort of reckless, haphazard, completely disrespectful way, because once again, there's this sort of artistic license to do that. And then to kind of throw Christianity into the mix, and you know, also this very kind of you know, frankly, just sacrilegious manner, and think that this is all okay in the context of you know, the sort of artistic whatever of putting the show together, I think is even beyond, you know, irresponsible, and is beyond insensitive, because it is trampling upon sacred meanings, and it's trampling upon a history that is oftentimes fraught with difficulty and suspicion and distrust, but also with a great deal of love and affection. And all of that got written out of I'm sorry, Kamala, I keep looking at, you know, of the story. And, you know, I think we as art makers and theater producers owe it to the larger community and the specific communities that we are deigning to represent to do better and to know better and to and to not be so utterly insensitive in the approach. So I just needed to put that out there. Malik and I had this really kind of crazy idea. we took trade routes, and to the best of my knowledge, this has not been done before. So we took this ancient trade route, the Silk Road, which essentially connected China to Syria, Turkey, the Balkans, and if you include the sea routes, from Japan to Italy. And we thought, you know, this is a model of what we would today call polyculturalism, which is a term that I actually prefer to multiculturalism. Although, you know, with all due respect to multiculturalism, polyculturalism to me is about the overlap, that intersection of culture, that collision, that meeting, that engagement between cultures, which is very representative of our experiences of living here in Chicago. For me, multiculturalism may have run its course a bit in that it's more about cultural silos. It's more about sort of a mosaic of cultures that are coexisting with each other, but very much within their own, you know, particularism and specificity. And I don't know how 21st century that is anymore. So we took these trade routes and we thought, you know, we wanted Silk Road peoples to represent themselves. And so we would be a playwright-focused theater, of course, mm-hmm. as these gentlemen here know. and we would follow something that I call the playwright-protagonist imperative, which was that the playwright and the protagonist, or central character, would be of the same background. And the playwright would be from the community about which he or she is writing. And, you know, it would not be celebratory work, it would not be, we are not a self-esteem project, you know, although we all need self-esteem. It's not about, is it, you know, great to be Chinese or it's great to be Indian, but really complex, complicated, sometimes controversial pieces that examine an experience and examine cultures within the respective, you know, the context in which cultures and communities exist, and playwrights who may have you know, who may be at odds somehow with how identity politics play themselves out in today's America, and maybe want to subvert those identity politics or somehow rewrite them or reimagine them. So you know, that was sort of the genesis of the Silk Road idea. So we coined our own identity politic in sort of debunking others, which is Silk Road peoples or Silk Road stories. So all of a sudden, you know, me with mixed Arab Slavic heritage, Malik with Pakistani heritage, everyone on this stage shared an identity, shared a story that we were calling Silk Road, you know, Silk Road stories and Silk Road narratives, and bringing that to Chicago in this very 21st century sort of diasporic ways. So how mostly Americans, primarily Americans of Silk Road backgrounds are telling their stories. So a big challenge was selling that to the communities, which we never really thought would be as big a challenge as it turned out to be, to tell the Chinese person that your story and an Indian story and so forth are sort of part of this larger story, and that there was this connection through these trade routes and blah, blah, blah. And early on, when we were doing Valina Hasu Houston's play, Tea, which was our second production, which is a Japanese-American story about Japanese war brides, we went to the Chinese and Korean communities and leadership and the Filipino community and, of course, the Japanese-American community. And a few people said, you do know we hate the Japanese, don't you? And I was like, well, I know there's this history. And that was really the beginning of a journey where, you know, we had to learn how to kind of parse out representation as it comes from within communities and how people wish to identify or self-identify or be identified or be represented, and that it is a much more intense challenge than we probably ever, you know, could have imagined. But we've seen success with that over time. You know, it was at first you couldn't get the Indian to come to the Japanese play, or the Japanese person to go to the Arab play, blah, blah, blah. And now we're seeing that cross-pollination. And also the fact that, you know, conflicts are with Silk Road countries. You know, the 21st century America, the Islamic world, China, India, Korea, if you look at sort of hotspots and this need for bridges, this need for building empathy and understanding and connections, this is in many respects, I believe, the century of the Silk Road and kind of a reimagined, reinterpreted Silk Road. And we have to be telling the stories of Silk Road peoples, and we cannot not, you know, we can't afford not to. So I think that the challenges, I truly believe have been more than worth it. And we're very proud with what we've been able to accomplish. But, you know, there just needs to be more. And there needs to be, more theater companies need to be doing this work, and more theater companies need to be taking these risks.
Absolutely. And a lot of the pushback I hear to that is, oh, well, there's not an audience for these types of stories. But here you guys are, 10 years later?
Yeah.
Wow. And there is an audience for these. There's an audience for this panel. So that's the challenge I put out to the small theaters out there and the big theaters that are in the audience right now.
And make investments in communities and work with communities.
Absolutely.
And that's something that we do all the time. And also bring the communities to the next story you're telling. Because, no one likes to feel like you only come around, when you're telling the Korean story
or
when you're telling the
Philippine.
Yeah. So I think that if people start feeling an investment, this is why this conversation, has to be about sort of organic, intrinsic changes within the community. Because when we do it cosmetically, when it is engineered, when it is sort of forced, it's not sincere, it's not genuine, and that's ultimately very transparent. And I think communities respond to that. It's tokenism, or it's somehow paternalism, and it doesn't work.
That's such a great, thank you for that segue. So I'm gonna have a question that I want to open up to the panel. What do the words authenticity and representation mean to you? And you at home can think about that as well. And in the Twitterverse.
Are you looking?
Whoever has the fire in the belly to say something.
One thing I just want to bring up that's kind of about this, I was speaking with Kirsten Brandt. I don't know if anyone knows her. She's Associate Artistic Director at San Jose Rep now. I believe she was the director, correct me if I'm wrong, of either the first version or an early version of Kite, of a staged production of Kite Runner. And she spoke with the playwright and everything just to make sure everything was on board. So she was the director, and she's not Afghan at all. And then they had their dramaturg. But, a dramaturg only has a certain job as well. They have to make sure the structure is working and there's continuity. And so they hired a cultural consultant. And I think this is an idea that can eventually get more play. And, you can't let small theaters off the hook because people work for free all the time just for the experience and for the, energy you get off of working with other people. But I think this is something to keep in mind more and more. You don't have to have an ethnically appropriate team, behind stage. But you can get somebody who really can help you say, like, you're hurt, she can't do this in the play. You can't mix that. You can't put her in white, because if she goes and talks to her dad wearing white, that means she wants him to die. Like, you need people like that, because otherwise, so that will help everybody, I think, if they can.
That was one of the things that Lavina Giovanni, who's the artistic director of Rosca Theater, when we were talking about Pippin, and she saw it, she said one of the most offensive things, and I might get the colors wrong again, so don't call me, but she said there's a character named Catherine in Pippin who is a widow, but she was wearing blue and white, and that in Hindu religion, that would just never, those colors wouldn't be appropriate for her, and that just spoke to me. Anyone else? Authenticity, representation?
In the 80s and 90s, there was this sort of notion of an authenticity holy grail, almost, that you could, that there was this that there would be the writer that would come along, or the subject matter, or the play that would really be authentic. And everybody was sort of working, and then people would fight about, you know, no, my thing's authentic and yours not authentic. And I think that that we problematize the notion of authenticity generally in a constructive way, which is to say that any of these communities, none of them is monolithic, right? And that there is a wide range of views in any community, and therefore no one writer, no one work can represent an entire community. So then the question becomes, okay, does that mean that it's like a total free-for-all? Well, no, that's not quite it either. Because I think any of us who works with material from a particular community, we know that in some sense, like, okay, I'm Chinese American, so a lot of my most vociferous critics are going to be from the Asian American community. Because these are the people who have the greatest investment in what it is
Absolutely.
That I'm writing. And so it's not that, but when you come to something, an informed situation, if you're informed when you're writing about a particular community or culture, that doesn't free you from controversy. If anything, it will cause controversy to take place. But you have to be informed enough to make intelligent decisions. You have to know why it is that you've chosen to do certain things and be prepared to defend that. And by the way, you can be wrong at certain points too, but it's the kind of what's most galling to me is when people come into these situations with that kind of arrogance, where it's like, well, you know, fuck it, I'm just being an artist, and then they get surprised when people criticize them. So you know, you can't have it both ways.
Right.
Very much define authenticity as that act of self-representation. So what, you know, and you can shoot 100 holes in that and so forth, but you know, the fact that historically Silk Road peoples have not been able to represent themselves in the West and have often been very poorly represented and sort of, you know, misrepresented and not represented and whatnot, and voiceless and invisibilized. We wanted to empower, you know, once again, the writers. We wanted to, and as writers, as playwrights, you know, people are probably going to have a somewhat contentious relationship with their own respective backgrounds and communities and want to explore that. So that is their authenticity, and that is, to me, an authentic relationship to one's heritage and to one's identity, and whether all the facts are correct or whether, you know, all the history and traditions are, I think it becomes irrelevant in their telling of the story. I mean, that might be something we want to, you know, correct in a table read or you know, with a dramaturg, but that it just resonate true to the writer, and to allow Silk Road writers that space to really explore their voice and, you know, and exercise their voice and not just be given that one chance, okay, you're out now, this sort of thing, but that this has to be part of a sustained trajectory, and that institutions, you know, really ought to once again make that sort of investment. I think all too often in trying to fill a slot or in trying to, you know, check a category or a box or whatever, someone gets, you know, sort of thrown a bone, and that's about it. And the, you know, the commitment to the artist sort of starts and stops there. And I think that, you know, we end up shortchanging, and obviously that's not just, you know, specific to Silk Road artists, but in our conversation about diversity, because once again, it tends to be defensive, it tends to be accusatory, it tends to be all these things, and you're saying I'm a bad person, but I'm a liberal, and you know, blah blah blah. you know, and I voted for Obama. we're just not going to that deeper place that, you know, we might otherwise go with someone, you know, somehow deemed mainstream.
Jay, did you
have
any?
Nothing enlightening.
But I do agree with my colleagues.
Great. Alright, here's the scariest question I came up with for myself. Like, because I like to work, And this question, like, could it put me out of work? If a story can't be told authentically, should it be told?
No.
No.
We just did an evening of skits in New York as a benefit for Mayu Writers Group, and they made an evening called the Orphan Nightingale, Molly
yes.
the Spectacular.
And
everybody read, little skits. And there was
tell them the tag. It was like, the Orphan of the Desert of the Nightingale.
A Bollywood Spectacular.
Spectacular. The reason why Asians are not always the best choice to play themselves on stage.
So, we started out with I can't remember who read this sketch, but they were going to do but the conceit was this theater decided to do an Asian version of the Three Little Pigs. And so, then they'd be like, well, I'm going to blow you down, but now I'm going to stop and make some origami. So there's often this desire to appropriate Asian stories in particular, because there's so fun and exotic, and you get all these great things you can do, little no dance and little ribbon dance. if you want to do that and you can't at least, authenticity is a complicated concept. Mm-hmm. If you can't at least hire Asian actors, no, don't do it.
Once again, that question of authenticity, and as David just said, it's really hard to define. I have been in the awkward position so many times since starting this company of having to explain and explain again and again, our mission with regards to that playwright protagonist role I mentioned. And, someone will contact me, and I just wrote this play about Gaza, and I spent time there, and I'm very much in solidarity with Palestinians, and which is great. I'm not Palestinian, or I'm not Arab American, or I'm not, and I'll explain to them. We have this rule, and I applaud you for the work you're doing, sort of. But that's not a play that we would produce. Just like a company that does plays buying about women or buying about LGBT people, whatever the case. It's a wonderful thing in the nonprofit sector is that we can define our missions as we see fit. Well, I had this one exchange, and I'm using the Gaza example because this was actually what happened, and she doesn't live in Chicago, so I assume she's not here.
She stands up in the back.
This woman ended up sending me 15 emails and all this name calling, and you're worse than the Ku Klux Klan, and you're like Hitler, and you're trying to erasing my voice and denying, I stopped replying after the third email. But she was really worked up, and she kept saying, you're demeaning my integrity, and you're sort of taking, and I'm like, the third response, and then like I said, it went on, but I said, God bless you. I hope you win the Pulitzer. I hope you get on Broadway and all of that with your play. We're not doing it. Because we don't define that within the context of authenticity as, once again, we define it as we have the right to define it. You may disagree with me, and once again, that's your right.
So that story was not told on Silk Road stage.
So it was not told, right. And, I'll get that, and our definition of authenticity will be disputed. And once
Absolutely.
Again, it's kind of like the casting question: what is the right answer? And we, I don't know that there is a single right answer, but I think that companies and individuals and artists and have the right to arrive at answers on their own. And we should always do it in dialogue, and we should always be open to change, certainly.
So this is my thought. Whitesnake, Greensnake was just done. It's Mary Zimmerman's latest production. Started at Oregon Shakes, went to Berkeley's, going all over. Tanya McBride is in it, and I forgot the name of the other lead. That is another Chinese fable, which they were required to use some of their ensemble members Mary at least had enough authority to, White Snake and Green Snake, both, they're supposed to be Chinese women, she was able to cast them. Casting anybody, I just spent 3 months at Pascal Rundicki, casting is not easy by any stretch of the imagination. I guess the one thing that I feel really strongly about is make your leads, and I wrote about this, make your leads your leads. Give the most empowered character on stage, keep them, could you? Like, because I understand, when you have a cast of 30, sometimes you're not going to be able to do whatever. But I think there's this habit to take the lead and stick a Caucasian in that role, and no offense, but you guys get to, like, it's your basketball, like, 90% of the time. You get to play the power person, the hero, the protagonist so much. I mean, I'm not saying I think everything should be multi-culti, but be very careful which times you take the power and the story and the resurrection away from somebody else and give it to somebody who has had that opportunity many times already.
Absolutely. It harkens back to what Jay was saying about it matters when, at what point is this this piece in production. For my piece, Mahal, it was really important to me to have as close an all-Filipino-American cast as possible with the Filipino-Americans, and thankfully we do, but it was that question the director and I went back and forth of, well, does it, you know, that actress was really good or that actor was really good, but the community doesn't have a play like this yet, and they're looking to have that play. So it's really important to have that representation. So it's tough. I don't know if I would have said, okay, well, we have this Chinese-American actor who's great, and we're going to cast them, if I wouldn't have, you know, if we would have still gone forward with it. We are at about 15 minutes till the close of the event, so thank you guys so much for, bringing so much great eloquence and great insights. So I just want to open it up now to the whole audience.
Is you back. Ask sort of how some of you would respond to, I think something, Danny, you were kind of heading towards when you said, I like to work, so I don't want to lose work for myself by asking, should we not stage particular shows unless you can have actors be authentic? And I think maybe what you were suggesting is like, oh, so I don't have the right then to be cast non-traditionally in a typically white play or whatever, right? Is that what you meant? And I feel like that is a frequent kind of sort of a rejoinder from people who want to have problems with non-traditional casting or casting authentically. And so how you guys would all respond to that?
Can I address that? Because I feel like the only consistent position on casting, because whenever you get into authenticity, you get into aesthetic judgments, of course they're necessarily subjective. But the only consistent position on casting is that it is to create a level, that we are seeking to create a more level playing field and create a more equal opportunity for actors. So if you look at the APAC statistics, for instance, this from the most recent, okay, it's 3% Asians, but it's 20%, all minorities, 20%. Okay, like in what industry would you go, that's acceptable?
Right.
So what we are trying to do is create a more level playing field, which in practice at this moment means creating more opportunities for minority actors. And if you don't do that, you go the way of the Republican Party. You shrink your audience, you're signing sort of the death for any industry. So there are really practical reasons to do that. And that's why when you have roles for minorities, you cast them as minorities. It's great to have minorities play roles that aren't defined as minority, but you don't have white people play roles for minorities because you're trying to expand the opportunities and create a more a level playing field.
And I would tack on that, something that's starting to gain kind of normalcy is putting out your casting notices and saying, you know, this person, age, but then now, like, if it's Caucasian, they spell out Caucasian. They spell out everything in there. Whereas before, you just had to, me as an actor had to assume, well, it says Anna, but it doesn't say Asian, so it's not me, because I just assumed it was white. But now it's people are getting much more sophisticated in how they put out their casting notices, and that is a help to everybody.
Absolutely. Can I just piggyback on all of that? I ask it. I'm moderating, so yes. There was a production of 5th of July by Lanford Wilson, 2009 at Oak Park Festival Theater, and they were having trouble casting the role of Jed. Michael Weber approached me, and he said, I want you for this role. And I looked at the script, I saw who was related to who, and I knew who I was going to cast in what roles. So I took the two roles that I could cast, like, non-white, and I want you in this role. And we started talking about it, we were talking about the project, it's great. And he's like, did you not see the casting notice? And I self-censored myself, I'm like, I did, and I didn't submit, because I didn't think I would ever. So I hold it on high authority that I'm the first Asian American to play this role, because it's a Vietnam War vet is his lover. And that created such a, I don't know, like in talking to the audience after, it was just great internal dialogue, having to negotiate that, but there was nothing about it in the play. So own it. Jane Adams.
Hi. I actually just had something happen to me this morning. I'm from Maine, which is 98% white. It's one of the reasons I left. but it's actually true. But this morning I was looking through the community theater that I worked with all through high school, which really turned me into the person that I am, and saw a picture of The King and I where the king looks like Grizzly Adams. But if you are in a small town that is 98% white, what then becomes more important to tell an authentic story using a cultural, I'm nervous now, a cultural consultant, for a group of artists that will then learn something that they didn't know before, but they're not authentic in that way, or not to tell the story, but then you have a percentage, a group of people who then aren't given the opportunity to learn about a culture that isn't their own, or are given the wrong stories. I'm not sure what the right answer is.
That's a really good question. So, if I can phrase that,
we're blessed to live in
Chicago.
Chicago, but when you go to the small towns,
should they be able to see a story that's not necessarily representative of the culture? Like,
how do you make it authentic?
But the opportunity for them to see this story.
Yeah.
Again, it goes back to the.
Yes. Okay. So I was the one who said if you can't cast it with Asians, don't do it.
Right.
But so.
I guess
I should put a caveat to that, because I mean, I do feel that there are situations, for instance, in high schools where you have generally in a lot of high schools in America, everybody plays everything, and in colleges everybody plays everything. And so in that context, I'm perfectly comfortable, and I'm comfortable in, you know, when you go to other countries, or I guess small towns, where you just don't have that acting pool. So I think there is a practical application too. But I still think that even in any of these contexts, the burden of proof falls on the theater to prove that it tried to find people, because otherwise they lie.
And I think, too, you're distinguishing between academic theater and maybe even community theater, too.
Mm-hmm.
And I just want to point out, too, for the audience, Jen Adams is the co-artistic director of Halcyon Theater, and they did Family Devotions a couple seasons ago.
And found all the Asian that they needed.
It was great.
We actually had a controversy because we had trouble casting Hannah, who I ended up playing. And I had a conflict, and things were dragging on, and she kept putting out notices. And I finally reached... I can't look at you, you're going to make me cry. I finally reached out, and I'm like, you know what, if you're going to cast this with a non-Asian, I'll drop it, everything.
Yeah.
And she was like, oh my god, it never occurred to me to not use an Asian. And I was like, who are you? What planet are you from? But I feel like people are all over the board, and we're just trying to like help this side of the board kind of sweep over to that part of the board.
And just a really quick housekeeping thing, I just asked Jamil if we could run a few minutes over, just because we started a few minutes late, because I know a lot of people have things to say or things to ask. So if you do need to go right at 8:30, you know, please, you're more than welcome to. But if for those of you who have stuff to say, bring it. Anyone else?
So, probably the greatest Hindu epic is the Ramayana, right?
Oh, yeah.
And it was done in Seattle, commissioned, original production. And I think the only role that was, forget South Asian, brown,
mm-hmm.
was the introductory narrator, the little boy that came out and kind of introduced the story. I sent people to see this. I've seen the script, I have the script, and it's a wonderful script. And the people I sent were Indophiles, very, very, you know, and up in arms about seeing this. And what I've got back, and I did a lot of my own research, was that it was a wonderfully told story that was authentic, accurate, and respectful. I was fortunate enough to have a discussion with the artistic director of the theater, which is how I got the script. And what I learned from him was that in Seattle, there was not, apparently, the pool that they were able to draw from, but they were really impassioned to tell this story. They partnered with all the South Asian scholars they could get their hands on. They worked with the art institute, the museums, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And that was how they became accurate in their storytelling. And frankly, that kind of thing to me is something that I applaud. And it's a great example of, yeah, they didn't have the South Asian actors, but they told this amazing story that their largely white audience came in and loved and learned a lot from.
To piggyback on that, though, in Chicago was a staging of the same story called Sita Ram at the Harris Theater, which partnered with South Asians to produce the dance. But in the case of in its multicultural casting, cast a white man as the hero, and had a black man play his servant as the monkey god, and had a Latino man play the demon who was vanquished. And so, in multicultural casting, we have to remember that our audiences are not race blind either.
Yeah.
And America has a history that plays out on the stage that you're watching, regardless of this being a Hindu mythology. So I think that this multicultural casting does play out in multiple ways for different types of audience members.
And we do have kind of the pool to be able to draw from in Chicago.
I want to bring up a production of Tempest that was, again, because I talked to Kirsten a lot last week. She did a Tempest, and she could cast her Prospero, but that was it. And she said, I'm not doing a black Caliban and a white Prospero. I'm just not doing that again, because it becomes about imperialism. The guy calls her up from theater, she's like, I've got the perfect Caliban, but he's African-American. She's like, okay, I'll at least see him. And he was right. He was the perfect Caliban. She said, okay, again, I got one more caveat. Your Ferdinand has to be black. So as long as you as the director are aware, and I don't know, you don't know Tempest, Ferdinand is the love interest. So as long as you got Caliban, that, but also your love interest, the one that's propelling the play, also of the same color, there are many solutions to this problem, or challenge, or puzzle.
Absolutely, and I'm going to popcorn around. So I'm going to, like, if it's not a question, if the panel, if it's a comment, like, come on, brought up, and you guys have responses, feel free to jump in. Sorry, raise hands. The gentleman, the best.
Yes, good to meet you. Okay. This room, filled with theater people, actors, directors, producers, writers, so forth, represents a sea change in Chicago theater history that has come about not overnight, but over many, many, many years. The kind of things you're talking about, authenticity, casting flexibility in a classic like The Tempest, whatever, are things that within my professional career and those of a few other people here were impossible. I've been doing theater in Chicago for about 45 years. The first Asian play that I can recall being done here was a late night second stage production of a one act play from the Yuan dynasty, which is Chinese 13th century, that was done at the Goodman Theater as part of its original Rock Chauffeurs back there. I think he was still a box office treasure with it. late night in the rehearsal hall. And there wasn't even a question of attempting to cast a Chinese classical play with Asian actors, let alone Chinese actors. Didn't exist in Chicago's professional community in 1974. About 10 years later, the Chicago Theater Project, for which I was literary manager, did a play called A Class C Trial in Yokohama by American playwright Roger Cornish, about military post-World War II trials of Japanese officials for war crimes. It had equal numbers of people who were supposed to be American GIs and Japanese characters. We had a call. We had a few Asian American actors who auditioned for us, but not a sufficient number to cast six or seven roles at a professional level. So we made the decision to cast it, we discussed it, with all European actors, none of whom appeared in yellowface, none of whom spoke pidgin English. We found other mechanisms to distinguish between the characters who were supposed to be Japanese and the characters who were supposed to be American. That was about 1983, or 1984. By 2005, I co-produced the Masrayana, a world premiere, with Rasaka Theater Company and Prop Theater Company, cast of about 13, and that time we could have a complete cast of Asian actors. I think 11 were South Asian. We had one Japanese American ringer, and I think we had one Filipino ringer. We also had a South Asian classical dance company and South Asian musicians. By that time, that had taken 30 years of my own personal involvement. You could achieve, let's call it, authenticity. So there's been a sea change represented by this, but there also is a change in audiences. I think the growth and development of a class of artists is ahead of the curve of the growth and development of an Asian audience, or more specifically, audiences. I'd be interested, Chay, in who is buying the single tickets for Disconnect. I'd be interested, you know, Jamil, will you ever be able to sell a play by a Chinese-American American playwright to Japanese-American ticket buyers? Will you ever be able to sell a play by a Middle Eastern author to South Asian audiences?
Yeah, that's so insane. I mean, it's not happening overnight, but we have come leaps and bounds. We've only got a few more minutes for the... Oh, no, it's fine. It's really inspiring. So I'm going to take some more, like two or three more points. But I encourage you, we have cards that if you didn't get called on, we have note cards that we ask you that, what are you leaving with? What are you inspired with? What hope, what change do you hope to happen? Leave them, write on them, leave them with us. And we're hoping to start a bigger conversation, thanks to Deb and the League, about this issue, not just with Asian Americans, but you know, all cultures. So, and again, API Chicago is a hashtag, so keep the conversation going. Yes.
I was just gonna say, one thing that hasn't happened in the sea changes with press and media, and I say that as a critic. There's an article that Time Out Chicago did a few years ago, why is Chicago theater so white? I think we can say, why is Chicago theater criticism so white?
Yes.
You know, and I think this speaks to what you were talking about, whether it was The Guardian, whoever that said, it doesn't matter, or, you know, and I saw the Pippin, I reviewed it for the Tribune, and I mean, I didn't have the level of sophistication to know that the colors of the costumes were wrong. I just knew the story just plain did not track. I mean, there was just no reason to paste this style or whatever they were calling it on this particular story. It did no service to the original, as far as I was concerned.
Mm-hmm.
But given that, I think that's a larger dialogue that needs to happen, and I don't know where we start engaging on that. I'm certainly not in a hiring position because, you know, I'm a freelancer. I go where I'm told to go, see what I'm told to see. But I do feel as if that's one place that has not kept up with audience, has not kept up with representation on stage, and that's not to say in any way that white critics can't write intelligently and feelingly about work from a variety of different cultural perspectives, but I do feel like it's something we don't talk about enough, and so I don't know where we... I'm just throwing that out there, because I don't know where we start the conversation around that, but I feel like I would be doing a disservice to myself if I didn't actually point out that maybe I'm part of the problem.
No, but that's such a great point. Yes.
Yes. Oh, yeah. I'm a musical theater student, and I'm kind of going back to what people said earlier. like in college and high school, we, like actors like me, can play different roles, but it's almost like in my program, I'm the only Asian American student, and the way they kind of nurture me is very, very good. They, you know, give me all the classes, they give me all the advice. They're telling me that it's gonna be okay and that you're good and everything, blah, blah. But I almost feel like, though, that for people like me who are about to go out and kind of go into the real world, it's almost like we either have to be really, really good that a director has to consciously say, oh, we're casting an Asian American actor for this big role, or I have to be kind of passable in order to blend in with kind of like the overall look of a production. So I guess kind of just like a question to everyone, like for, you know, young actors that are about to go out into the real world that kind of have this problem to face, and like we all talked about it, it's kind of a downer. But like, you know, how, like what are we kind of supposed to do, or like what can we do?
B.D. Wong, I forgot what book it was in, but Harvey Fierstein had just done Torch Song Trilogy off Broadway, which is about, you know, white gay people. And to sum it up, white gay people. But B.D. Wong, who was like, you know, very young at the time, like, he came up to Harvey Fierstein and said, I love the play, it was great, why couldn't you cast, would you cast me as the foster son? And it got Harvey Fierstein thinking, and he noted that experience. When they cast the movie, they cast a Latino actor. Matthew Broderick originated the role. You know, so it's, you have to put yourself out there. I'm in constant conversation with my agent. I'm like, put me out. I mean, like, there's no reason why I shouldn't be submitted for these things if it's, or submit me even if it says white or his, you know, whatever it says, submit me. So, go ahead.
One thing, the wonderful thing is, because we are finally coming of age, we second generation native speaker artists. And the thing is, what's so great is you count. You count in a way that 50 years from now, it's going to be harder. Yeah, because we're going to have a bigger foundation. There are going to be more shoulders that all of us are, you know, going to be standing on. So do your art, because inspiration begets inspiration. And we want to look back 50 years from now and be like, you know, we all rose to the occasion. We've done good. 2012, it was what it was, but like, but we showed up, so show up, speak up, make your art.
I'll just say one quick thing. I just spent some time in Denver working with Andre and Shields and a cast of 10 black actors. And before we went on to do this reading, Andre says, we have to do much better than everyone else here. And this is a man who's a legend in the theater world. And to that, I would just say, be more than excellent. Mm. Because you have a face and a look doesn't guarantee you anything. You have to be better than anyone else, because this is about your art. It's a lifestyle, it's a calling, it's not a job.
Yeah. So this, please stay in Chicago.
Yeah. So again, I need to cut the conversation short, because this is such, again, like our friend here in the middle said, it's not an overnight change, but it is changing. And we are all a part of that change, which is really exciting and inspiring. So the last quick, and again, I say quick, because we have to be mindful of people's time, as succinctly as possible, and it's a big question, so shoot me after this, what change or action would you like to see come from tonight? Or maybe we just leave it as a question.
I think it's that everybody thinks about these decisions before they make them. I think a lot of these things happen because people just aren't thinking about them, and then, you know, and then they just go, okay, we're just gonna do the Nightingale, and yeah, let's put, this will be fun, we'll cast all sorts of people, and then everybody gets mad and they're like, whoa, what happened? So, you know, think.
Yeah. And beyond that too, I'll just say, sometimes go beyond thinking, just do. Because I was in one diversity panel, which is a national panel in New York, and everyone agreed to think about it more. I'm sorry, sweetie. Just do. Yeah. And try it. If you fail, try again. I think this is a society that needs to be doing things.
Stop giving artistic directors so much power. You know, self-produce, get your work out there. You know, there's only so many productions that any of us can produce in a given year, and there are mechanisms for mounting a show. I mean, essentially that's, you know, Malik and I, not coming from the theater, one day said, we're going to run a theater, and we're going to, yeah, and didn't have any of the sort of the guidebooks or the voices in our head. We just did it. So, you know, I would encourage others to take that plunge. And if you're not getting space at X Theater, then, you know, create your own space.
And remember that it is, art is about always looking forward. Take me someplace new, you know, that, so keep the big picture in mind and just remember that we're going to look back now and be like, we made mistakes then too, but that's how it is when you're on the leading edge, and it's okay.
What I will say for myself on what action I'd like to change, just to close it all up, is that the reason I love to do theater in Chicago is the community. We are a really tight, supportive community. If we fall, we pick each other up. And I think that that is what distinguishes us from any other city. You look around in this room. Like, look around this room right now. There are, you know, every color, every actors, directors, producers, there's everyone here. I think the change that we can at least start tonight is to talk and connect and make sure that these connections keep going and that this dialogue keeps going with each other. So, and there are many ways to do that. Obviously, please write on those note cards. Keep in touch with each other. I don't know, it's such a small community. It's great. Follow this hashtag. Let us know your thoughts. Closing up, I want to thank, again, Silk Road Rising for hosting us. Deb Clapp and the League of Chicago Theaters and the whole team there, especially Ben, Victory Gardens, Chay, especially Tim and Jeffrey, who have been so instrumental in this conversation, Lifeline, Dorothy, and Allison, who have been so open and receptive to a lot of, you know, really tough conversations, and Adam Belcourt Goodman for, again, being instrumental in this discussion as well. So thank you. Some of us will be staying around if you want to. If this is being recorded, it will be posted on Silk Road?
Yes, and we'll send out the links to everyone so we can, you know, post it all over.
And yeah, so thank you so much for coming.